364. When y'all walked in the door, man, I just felt a wave come in because y'all are the temples of the Holy Spirit. When we get together, we worship Him in spirit and in truth. There's nothing that can beat that, is it? Yeah. Anywhere you could be this morning is not going to beat where you're right now. With the family of God, people of God reaching out and touching Him, He's going to say something today. He's going to speak, and we're going to leave here different than when we came. Glory to His name. Let me begin by declaring that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Oh, Heavenly Father. Holy Spirit is here. thank you for that gift of the Holy Spirit. Lord, you flow through us like rivers of living water, continuously refreshing, continuously replenishing us in our spirit, Lord. Some of us feel dry and thirsty, Lord. Some of us feel like it's been a week that we've just had so many challenges and so many heartaches, possibly. Maybe we need wisdom. Maybe we need a special touch from you. But, Lord, you touch us. He touched me a long time ago, Lord, and you're touching me every single day that I walk with you, Lord Jesus. I thank you that we can reach out and touch the hem of your garment this morning, Lord, and that you will meet us right where we're at. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for what you're about to do in this service. We worship you. You are alone and worthy to receive praise and honor and glory and thanksgiving now and forever. Lord Jesus, work in your church. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Lord, we come before you today asking you to just come and be with us, dwell with us, dine with us, Lord. Let us dine with you. And we love you and we bless you. We're looking forward to what you're going to do. Thank you, Lord Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. We speak these things in your name. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Glory to God. What's that number, 367?
Victory.
Thank you.
we'll see some more.
This is what we do. Some whenever Pastor Mark and I get together, we just goof off and go.
We have a great gathering.
Well, thank you. It's fun.
So we have. We ain't got to do it in a couple of years, but man, when we used to do it, we'd be here for 3 or 4 hours.
We would. I'm just saying, we need to get another session like that because that carries us for months at a time when we sing like that. And, yeah, even though we kind of know what each other's going to do, but you're doing a great job, Tony. Thank you so much for what you do for us.
Oh,
Ginger, I want to ask you, and I don't mean to put you on the spot, do you have any new information from the CAM Center for us?
No, nobody's asking for a ticket.
Okay. You know me and Angie want two, right?
Yes.
That's two, and you've got a bunch of them, don't you?
I have 22, and I have to turn in while I got here to buy it. Mm-hmm. And although they are $25
mm-hmm.
They're free tickets.
Okay.
It won't cost
anything.
All right. There are paper donations, but you can get, I guess, a little or as much as you want.
For people who weren't here last week, just tell us in a nutshell what we're talking about. You want to come up here?
Yeah.
Might be better where we can hear you.
Yeah.
This is important. This is something that the Lord brought to me, and then he brought it to Ginger. Neither one of us knew that the other one was looking at it. And one day we began to compare notes, and I said, you know, I think the Lord is doing something here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Come to Life Ministries is a pregnancy care center for mothers. And they're having a banquet Saturday night, starts at 6:30. And the theme of the banquet, let me get paperwork out here, is from Psalm 36, 7 through 9. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of light. In your light we see light. And I think that's a beautiful scripture passage. The evening is a celebrate life banquet. And it's going to be at Bethlehem Church. And it's over on Christmas Avenue. And I have plenty of tickets. If somebody wanted to come and even bring some of their family with them. And like I said, they're free. And it's being catered by the Master's Table. We're going to have an excellent speaker. We're going to have some excellent music by Susan Shubrick, I think that's her name. And the keynote speaker is Abby West. And I've told y'all, I think last week, that she grew up in Orange County, California. She is an ex-gang member. And she is a two-time teen mom. And she was faced once with a decision to terminate herself and an unborn child. And however, through God's amazing grace, she has been redeemed and has lived to talk about it. She's now a police officer in Cleveland, Tennessee, since over 22 years.
Wow.
So that's really a testimony, and I think it's going to be very exciting.
What time?
Saturday?
It's Saturday at 6:30.
Angie and I are definitely going.
Okay.
I would love for you, any of you guys to join us. I think it's a great thing. Right here in our neighborhood, it's a way we can reach out and touch unwed mothers and help serve their needs and give them a strong alternative to abortion.
Yes. And they're not necessarily unwed, I don't think.
Not all of them, yeah. I mean,
no.
It's needy.
Just have a need. Two.
Fantastic. And it's by donation. They're free, but you donate whatever you feel led to do.
Wow.
We get crowds.
I have mommy that night. I'll do that.
You know it's going to be good food from the Master's Table.
Oh,
too.
Yeah.
I don't know what they're going to have, but I know that last year they had beef tips with gravy, twice baked potatoes, roasted potatoes, glazed carrots, green beans,
salad,
assorted
bread.
Isn't
that who's doing our Christmas?
I'll ask them to. Here, aren't we? We've already got that
plan.
What?
Okay,
well,
just
make
them.
Better start early. If you think about it later on, we can get one to you during the week, too, I guess. I mean,
mm-hmm.
If you know somebody else needs one.
Okay.
I think we went a couple of years ago, didn't we? three or 4 years ago.
Somebody said that they had been here before I came. They had been just before.
Yeah, we were here before. It was very nice.
Okay. Well, nice. Very nice. Was that all, Ginger? Thank you so much. Ginger's going to be our liaison. You know, the Lord has given her a very special heart for babies and unwed mothers and struggling mothers. She told me that Ginger was actually working in a NICU when she was 17, 18 years old. Isn't that right, Ginger? Mm-hmm. Working with babies in distress and working with families, and she just has a real special ministry. I think God's doing something here. Ginger had been looking for where God would use her and where God would place her, and this came along, and like I said, I heard about it completely independent of her, and I think God's doing something. I think you guys are all part of it too, so amen. Amen. Anybody else got any questions or anything about that before we go into prayer requests? Well, good, good. We'll have a good show in here, and I'm looking forward to it. Let's talk about what the Lord is doing. He's doing this right here that we just talked about, obviously doing so many things in our church. Let's hear what he's doing. I'd love to hear your prayer requests. Who's got something today?
We got a good week.
Real good week.
Yay.
Tell us about it. Tell us why it's good.
A little less friction.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't mean personal stuff. I just meant, I thought you meant the church.
Well, this is my family.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's good news.
A little less friction.
Good news.
All the way around. Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God for every good step.
Peace like a river. That's what we pray for, isn't it?
Sometimes your mom is as stubborn as you are, and you have to back up and
say
that I'm not in control.
Yeah.
That's right. Let go and let God, right?
Yeah.
Glory to God. That's what he does. That's how he works. Who else?
King's back in the hospital.
Oh, no. I was just praying for him last night, thinking about him. What's going on?
He's going to have a pacemaker.
Pacemaker. Well, maybe that will.
He's on dialysis, and now he's going to have a pacemaker. So just keep him in.
Kenny is what, in his 60s maybe? Like we about our age?
About 66 maybe. 66.
Yeah, he's 2 or 3 years younger than me.
Yeah. I knew he was not an elderly man. He just had this health thing coming up. I was praying for him last night, and I said I really wanted to find out about him. I need to get a phone number from you too sometime.
Yeah.
If you think you see, he may not be a phone person. Some people don't really enjoy phone calls.
Oh, he don't mind talking on the phone.
Oh, does he? Okay. Well, good.
No, he don't.
I'm not that much of a phone person, but I do like to call people and encourage them when I can, But thank God he's with him, and this pacemaker will be a blessing, actually, where his heart can catch up and do right, and maybe it'll influence the rest of his health. Who else? Yes, Tina.
We have another miracle.
Tell us about it.
The last time Tony had a CT scan,
mm-hmm.
he had a new tumor appear in his lung.
Mm-hmm.
They did this one, and it's disappeared.
Praise
the Lord.
Did we ask God to disappear that thing? Yeah. I'll take it.
And I'd like to praise God for all the cars over there across the street. Yeah. That looks so good.
Yeah.
I mean, I really wish ours was like that, but that's like old times.
Well, I wasn't paying attention. It's full.
Yeah, the whole parking lot.
Well, thank God. Thank God.
Got to find out what they're doing.
Praise God for their success.
I know a lot of them came from Monroe.
Yeah.
Over here because it was closer. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Yeah. So I'm just catching up on writing these things down. Y'all tell me some more.
School starting, man.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I got to get up early
teachers
on
the teachers and the students.
Yeah. I was looking for Amanda yesterday, Friday we had our meeting. We had an active shooter training in North Oconee. All the teachers were there, but I didn't see her. I'm sure she was there somewhere.
Yeah.
School starting. I'll be getting up at 4:30 in the morning from now on.
Wow.
I got a much bigger bus route this year. They got so many more kids and so few drivers that they're putting combining routes. Pray for me. It won't be so bad, but it'll be challenging the first week especially. So pray for our safety and pray for my wisdom and that I'll do things right and buy the book and all that. So who else? Yes, Jim?
Did everybody know that down past the middle school, that's, I thought it was going to be a new subdivision. That's a high school.
They're building a high school right down here?
That's a high school right now.
It's already on the map.
Oh, I didn't know. Wow. I thought it was a subdivision.
Right here, Creek.
And yeah, Bear
they're
Creek.
They're calling it Small Creek.
Small Creek.
Below this middle school?
Mm-hmm.
I did too.
Nope.
Well, for the 50s, State of had a high school.
Yeah.
I guess there's so many more things.
Yeah, so many people flood into the area to do something. State of High School.
Small Creek High School.
Well,
that's what it says. It says it on the Google map already. They need to change that
name. Wow. Interesting.
Katie's supposed to be centered in high school this year. I thought she was going to Wander.
Well, it's not done yet.
Okay. It'll be a year more before it starts.
I kept wondering, how are they going to put a house in that little big spot? It's just the entrance.
Who else? Yes, Mr. Bobby.
Dory was in Elijah Price and graduated from state of 1985.
Is that right? Wow. And then they just combined with one there. Well, how about that? Speaking of Mr. Bobby, did we have a good time celebrating his birthday last week? That was so much fun.
And I really appreciate that.
It was fun. Thank you.
And can't see how I was kept in this secret. That long, I didn't know anything about it. I walked in the door, and I knew the daughter and son-in-law was over here, but I didn't know why. But thank you to everyone that was involved.
Well, it was so much fun. Anytime we get together, it's fun. But we celebrate a great man of God like Bobby Morris. It's just that much better. And so thank you for letting us be a part of your life and part of your celebration.
I'll try to make it to another one.
Absolutely, you will. You don't mean no try to. God's got plans for you. You got to go to the Holy Land.
Yeah.
You told me you're heading to the Holy Land maybe next year or sometime, right? So, yeah, God's already ordered it. He's got work for you to do.
These newer members don't know how long he's been in this church working.
Yeah.
He's been here a long time.
Long time. Thank God for longevity and deep spiritual roots. You too, Miss Brenda. You've got deep roots here. So thank God for that. I thank God for that. All y'all do. Man, Craig's been here since he was a baby. You can't remember not being here, can you?
Brenda's mom taught my kids Sunday school.
How about that? God's still got great plans for this church, too, as we move forward. Yes, Misty? All the people who aren't here, my wife included. She's not sick, she's just tired, and she said she needed a day of rest. So. Pardon? Beverly. We need to pray for Beverly. She's on her crib. Yeah, that's what Missy's asking us to pray for. And Angie and the ones that aren't here. Thank you, Missy. Who else?
Roxy asked for travel prayers for our kids going back to Texas.
Travel prayers. Who is that that's going?
Kelly,
okay. Okay, we will certainly lift them up. Jean, so good to have you here.
Praise the Lord.
God is working day by day, right?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Anything you have on your heart you want to share with us?
Just healing.
Just healing. Continued and complete healing. And wholeness and wellness. And God's got this. He's taking care of things day by day, step by step. Somebody else wave a hand. There we go.
Keep Jack on your bird.
Jack, for sure. And still no real word from any doctor. Is it this?
He goes to Emory on Tuesday.
Okay.
Of the 8th, I think it is. Next, not this Tuesday, but next.
Okay.
So hopefully.
Maybe they'll get some answers.
We're praying for a miracle like that.
Absolutely. God did it for Tony. He'll do it for Jack. He's not a respecter of persons. Amen. Amen. Okay. Everybody ready to pray? Mr. Clinton, sorry.
Tomorrow I celebrate my 52nd wedding anniversary.
52 years.
Congratulations. Congratulations. To the same thing.
Happy anniversary. Happy anniversary.
Yes, Joan.
It's not a big deal, but I'm going to have surgery on my right hand at the end of August, and they're going to combine like 3 or 4 different things to maybe get it functioning properly again.
Just sew it all up in there.
Well, they're going to unlock the middle and the ring finger and then take them. He said that's not just arthritis, there's a cyst also in there, so they're going to remove that, possibly a cyst in this one too.
Okay.
So they're just going to do it all in one.
Get y'all cleaned out.
Hopefully.
Good. Good. Praise God. It's going to be good. God's going to take care of it. When is that going to be, Joan?
The 29th.
Start lifting her up. All right, is that everybody? Y'all ready to pray? Let's go to the Lord and seek the Lord silently for a moment. And once again, silent does not mean altogether silent. If the Lord gives you a prayer to pray out, please feel free. If the Lord gives you a praise, just shout it out. It'll bless somebody. But we'll know when the time is right. And God will give us a pastoral prayer, and then we'll pray the Lord's Prayer all together as we always do. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon his name while he is near. Join me in a season of prayer, if you will. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you're so powerful, so wonderful, so very good to us. Praise you, Lord. Praise your name, Jesus. Oh, Lord, we just want to bask in your presence, God. It's just so good just to be in your presence, Lord, just to know you are the Lord our God. You are working in our lives. Even when we don't feel it, you're working. Even when we don't see it, you're at work, Lord Jesus. You're making our path straight. You're creating opportunities. You're keeping us safe from harm. You're going out ahead of us. And Lord, in ways that we won't even know for years, possibly, God, that you are ordering our paths according to Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to worry. Lord, there's a reason you told us not to worry, not to be afraid, because you love us. You have plans for us. Lord, you know, Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you. You have plans to give us hope and a future. Lord, you already see that future and how glorious it is. God, I think about this church and the deep roots that people have. Thank you for those deep, deep roots, Lord. We have people who go all back all their whole lives here. Lord, some who have just joined recently. And Lord, together, we're going forward into the future that you have for us. And God, you already know what's there. You're calling us in the direction that we need to go. And Lord, we're going to listen. We're going to be attentive. We're going to seek you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength through your word, through fellowship, through prayer, and through following after the opportunities that you open for us, Lord Jesus. I pray, God, that you would let us be very vigilant to hear and to listen, that we wouldn't miss something that you're trying to teach us, Lord, and that we wouldn't create an opportunity that's not coming from you, Lord Jesus. Give us wisdom and discernment, I pray. Thank you for State of Methodist Church, Lord. Thank you for us going forward, God. We've got a lot of decisions to make. God, the future is glorious. Lord, I thank you for these prayer requests that came up today. I'm going to speak each one before your name. Lord, you know each one intimately, but God, there's power when we hear us bring it before you, Lord. We hear the names called, the situations enunciated, Lord, so that we can understand how great you are, how mighty you are. Lord, you've just demonstrated how powerful you are, Lord, and making that tumor disappear in Coney Chronic, Lord. We already called him the miracle man, Lord, and now he's even demonstrating that further, God, as he depends on you. Lord Jesus, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord God. You are our healer, Lord Jesus. You use doctors and medicine, but Lord Jesus, healing is in your hand. And I thank you for that, Lord Jesus. Thank you for touching Tony. Lord, continue to touch him. Thank you for touching Jan as she stands by his side, Lord, in her own surgery that she just had. God, I thank you for touching folks. Pat's knees are working better every day. Jean is getting better every day, Lord. Step by step, you're rebuilding her, Lord, and after her surgeries, God, and I pray that you continue to work in her life. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. Lord, we didn't mention it today, but I continue to pray for Miss Brenda's rotator cuff, for her shoulder injury that hurts at times. Lord, I pray that you would restore her fully, God. She loves to plant. She loves to dig in the dirt. And she loves to do things around the house, God. I pray the pain would be gone in Jesus' name. Touch her, Lord, I pray. God, for Jack, Lord, we don't understand. The doctors don't understand, apparently, God. But I pray that you would go before him. And these doctors at Emory are supposed to be the best in the world at what they do, Lord. And I thank you for that. I thank you for that knowledge that you've given them, the technology you've given them. But Lord, I pray you open their eyes, Lord, to even the most remote possibility that it could be. Lord, that they would understand how to apply that knowledge, God, that it would be applied in a way that you will use to heal them 100%, God. Now, Lord, we accept it, Lord, and we believe that you will heal him right now without the aid of doctors. But God, according to your will, Lord, you've directed this path to him. And God, I speak blessings and healing and grace and mercy over Jack right now in Jesus' name. in Jesus' name. Lord, also thinking about, we didn't mention her today, but Craig's sister, Lord, was facing cancer, Lord, in surgery. And we want to lift her up, God. We want to bless her and ask you to touch that situation in Jesus' name. Lord, for Miss Beth and Ann, as she takes such loving, tender care of her mother, God, I pray you continue to give her strength for the journey. Lord, bless her, God, richly. I believe that there is a special blessing for those who take care of their parents the way that you've asked us to in your word, Lord. Well, you told us that we give honor to those who raised us, Lord. I bless her and her sister and all the folks who add to her care, Craig, and all the whole family, Lord. It's a big team effort, God. I pray in Jesus' name you touch them, Lord. Bless them. Give them peace and strength for the journey. Lord, bless Miss Beth. Lord, you love her so much, God. I pray you give her a peace, Lord, and a calm in her spirit, God, that she would understand, God, and that she would know how much you love her and how much people love her around her, God, and feel safe. And Lord, I pray for the folks who aren't here that Misty lifted up today, God. Beverly is on her on one of her journeys, God, and she's probably listening to us today. I bless her, Lord. I ask you to give her safe passage. Lord, Beverly asks that we pray for a family member who had to put their dog down while she was there, God. It was just a precious little dog, and God, I just pray that you just heal their hearts. Lord, I understand. We all understand what it's like to lose a precious pet. And Lord, I pray for peace and contentment, God, and that you would just enrich the memories of that little dog that would bless them so much, God, and that their hearts would be healed. Lord, I thank you for Glenda's praise, God, that peace in the family, Lord, wholeness, health, and wellness, Lord, over the family. God, I speak that over all families in this church, Lord. Oh, Lord, I come against strife. I come against rebellion. I come against all the things that the devil uses to try to derail our families, to discourage us, Lord, to keep us from pursuing you with all of our heart, with all of our soul, Lord. It divides our spirit, God, because we're so worried about things. Lord, I thank you for peace. It comes in the morning, Lord, when you take over a situation, God. And I just pray that you continue, Lord, to let that peace multiply itself in Glenda's life and in her family, Lord, in Jesus' name. Thank you so much, Lord Jesus. And Lord, for Joan going for this surgery on the 29th, Lord, I pray her hand would operate absolutely perfectly, God, that once the rehab goes on, Lord, that you would just reconstruct her hand, Lord. Use the surgeon to reconstruct her hand. Bless her, Lord, and I pray you give her peace about the surgery in Jesus' name. Lord, Kelly is heading back to Texas. Travel plans. Pat asked for peace and protection for her children as they travel toward Texas. God, I pray that you bless them. The angels would go before them, Lord, that their speed would be kept in check, and all those around them, Lord, that there would be no traps, Lord, of Satan, drunk drivers, distracted drivers, anything like this, Lord, in their path. God, clear it, I pray, in Jesus' name. Touch them, give them safe passage, and I pray. For my own wife at home today, Lord, I pray you touch her and bless her, God. And thank you for her standing by my side all these years, Lord. I bless Angie now. Lord, for Linda Aaron at Tarabella, God, she's such a good friend and loves this church, Lord. She tunes in with us every week. Having certain health struggles, God, you know what they are. I pray that you would touch her, Lord, that you would just lift her up and encourage her spirit, Lord. Give her peace. And Lord, for all my dear friends over there at Tarabella, I pray that you touch them and bless them, God. You know the needs. Lord, I thank you for everything, Lord. I pray that I haven't missed anything, God, but the beauty is that you never miss anything, God. You know everyone's need, God, and you're willing to help. You're willing to touch us. Lord, we need to listen to you. We need to tune our hearts to you, Lord. Lord, and we have to accept the help that you give, Lord. And I pray, God, that you would help us be ever vigilant, God, that we need to just reach out to you, Lord, by faith. Lord, you operate in our lives by faith, Lord. I pray that we would reach out to you in Jesus' name by faith and receive the blessing you have for us. Lord, we bless you and praise you and we thank you. And now we pray, as Jesus taught us in the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen and amen. Bobby, would you grab our offering plate for us? And bring it behind you. That's okay. You can. Hey, that's the main thing. Hey, Anastasia and children. How's everybody doing today? Oh, guys, I'm so proud of y'all giving the way you do. It's just unheard of. Most preachers have to talk about money all the time and read scriptures on money and ask for money. We don't have to do that around here because you guys are so faithful. Y'all amaze me with your faithfulness, and it amazes God, I believe, so much so that He pours out His Spirit here richly. He has a great future for us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray over this offering and let's lift it up. Heavenly Father, thank You so much for what You're doing in the earth today, Lord, and letting us be a part of it, God. Let us have eyes to see and ears to hear where we need to sow. Lord, this money, this funding will go out beyond these stained glass windows and these four walls into the furthermost points of the earth that You direct us to, Lord. Give us opportunity, give us inspiration, give us eyes to see, ears to hear. This is Your money, Lord Jesus. Thank You for entrusting it to us. We will ever remember that, and we will use it according to Your glory and Your honor and for Your kingdom and its purposes, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. We have here today. Tony, we don't really have a special plan. Is there a special song you want to do, or is there something some of you guys would like for us to sing, like a worship song? Or we're totally open today. We didn't plan one.
But she asked, did we do Victory in Jesus?
We did. We did that.
We already did that one. Okay.
Anybody got a favorite? You got a favorite? In the garden. I almost said that. In the garden.
Let's... I come to thank you.
talking, Dinos. That's a perfect selection. Y'all ready for some preaching?
Amen.
I'm ready to preach. I'm always ready to preach. I love preaching more than anything, almost. It's good to be in your presence. Y'all are easy to preach to. Sometimes it's not so easy to preach. But you guys soak it up. I see it in your faces. I hear you. I see you listening to God, hearing from the Lord. That just makes a preacher's heart just beat. And I'm so thankful for y'all. Have I told y'all lately that I love you? I was laying in bed last night. I hope y'all know that. But I need to tell you. I need to be sure I tell you, because I was laying in bed last night and my heart was just consumed with love for you all. It is every night. But I said, I need to tell them in the morning. I need to make sure you know how much I love you and how much this church has meant to me and Angie. And there's just no doubt in my mind that we're where God brought us and where we need to be. And God is doing some amazing and miraculous things here in this church. And I'm so thankful to just be a small part of it and to get to worship God with you guys. Today, we're going back to Job for the 9th sermon in Job. There'll probably be a few more, maybe 3 more, but we're getting towards the end of the book. We did a big summary from about chapter 4 on to about chapter 31. That's the three friends, the three amigos that we talked about last week. The three friends, Bildad, Zophar, and Eliphaz, who had all this great input for Job. And Job said, you guys came to help me, but you wound up tormenting me. He said, I wish you'd just leave. Your tormentors. They got in this huge argument. They went back and forth. They were convinced that Job had somehow sinned and he wasn't being honest with them. He wasn't being straightforward. They said, where there's smoke, there's a fire. And Job, you know how God is. God sees something that you're not telling us. And you have missed it, brother. And there's a distinct tone in their voice that there was no going back. You're just done. You've had your day. You had all this money, all this stuff, and you just disappointed God. You let God down. You said something, made God mad. You're done. You're done. And man, it's the most fatalistic thing. If you read it, I hope you guys read through there. It's a little bit hard to read, but boy, it will just overwhelm your soul. There'll be a nugget of truth in some of the things that they say, and then they'll turn around and just torpedo it because they start talking for the devil. Start talking for the devil and just negate the good stuff that they had said. And Job does the same thing. Job keeps insisting, I'm righteous. I haven't done anything to deserve this. God has flat out turned on me. God has taken everything from me. And I don't deserve this. And he begins to declare his own self-righteousness. Job had it wrong. They had it wrong. Dear friends, God needed to speak into Job's situation. We know how it all started with God declared Job a righteous man. God said, there is no better man in the earth than Job, the man who lives in the land of Uz. And he said, I have blessed him greatly. But then Job went through the storms of his life, the trials of his life. You know the story. We've been over it several times, and I don't want to repeat too much of it. Let's jump in today, chapter 32, if you want to turn there. I want to read that whole chapter. It may take just a minute. There's 20 verses, and I may skip around a little bit for expediency's sake. But let's read the word of God, Job chapter 32. So these three men stopped answering Job because he was righteous in his own eyes. But Elihu, son of Barakel, the Buzite of the family of Ram, became very angry with Job for justifying himself rather than God. He was also angry with the three friends because they had found no way to refute Job, and yet they had condemned him. Now Elihu had waited before speaking to Job because they were older than he. But when he saw that the three men had nothing more to say, his anger was aroused. So Elihu, the son of Barakel the Buzite, said, I am young in years, and you are old. That's why I was fearful. Not daring to tell you what I know, I thought age should speak, advanced years should teach wisdom. But it is the spirit in a person, the breath of the Almighty, that gives them understanding. It is not only the old who are wise, not only the aged who understand what is right. Therefore I say, listen to me. I too will tell you what I know. I waited while you spoke. I listened to your reasoning while you were searching for words. I gave you my full attention, but not one of you has proved Job wrong. None of you has answered his arguments. Do not say that we have found wisdom. Let God, not a man, refute him. But Job has marshaled his words against me, and I will not answer him with your arguments. They are dismayed and have no more to say. Words have failed them. Must I wait now that they are silent? Now that they stand there with no reply? I too will have my say. I too will tell what I know. For I am full of words, and the spirit within me compels me. Inside, I'm like a bottled up wine, like new wineskins ready to burst. I must speak and find relief. I must open my lips and reply. I will show no partiality, nor will I flatter anyone. For if I were skilled in flattery, my maker would soon take me away. Dear friends, this is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, help us. God, these are heavy words. Lord, they are interesting words. They are words that apply to our lives. Lord, give us revelation and utterance, Lord, and discernment that we would speak the truth of your scriptures today, God. Help us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The essence of the lesson. The Holy Spirit will reveal God's wisdom to his children as we humble ourselves, pray, and listen. It's Christianity 101, isn't it? Humble yourself, pray, and listen. We started learning that in Sunday school when we were John's age back there. We've heard it all of our lives, but have we been able to apply it to our lives? Humble ourselves, pray, and listen. These guys were Bible scholars, apparently, or scholars of the law in those days, who were talking with Job, and they thought they knew all about God. They had worshiped God for years, and they had been taught by their parents, they had been taught by their traditions and their religious views, and they all had the answer for Job. And then Job had a comeback for everything they could say. They were just bouncing religious exercises off of each other continuously, and it came to naught. It came to nothing. And there was this young guy, Elihu, who had been sitting there the whole time. Some of those guys were pretty old. One of them was older than Job. He was old enough to be Job's father, and we could assume that Job was old enough to have grown children and grandchildren and a big business, a big family. So these guys were on in years, and sometimes we respect that. And I respect my elders. I respect people who are older, people who have lived longer than I have, people who have been through more than I have. And I often go to older folks. I see a lot of older folks in my job, and I'll tap their ears for advice sometimes. I'll run a situation by them, and there's great value in that. There's great value in knowing when to speak and having consideration for your elders and the ones who have gone before you. And I really admire the fact that he sat there probably for days, hour after hour. He was just taking it all in. He was just listening. They go back and forth. And I'm sure he wanted to jump in at some point. He probably just, I can't wait. The Lord would calm his heart and say, it's not your time yet, Elihu. Not your time yet. But here in chapter 32, we find when his time came. They had gone through these circular arguments, round and round. Nothing had been accomplished except just pure frustration. And finally, the Spirit of God gave Elihu the green light to go ahead. The whole time, this guy had been sitting there, I believe, listening to the Lord. We have to remember, in those days, the old covenant, the ancient days, they didn't have the understanding that we have. They didn't have the benefits of the new covenant that we enjoy so freely. Jesus had not yet died and rose again and gone back to the right hand of the Father and sent the gift of the Holy Spirit that he promised us would be like rivers of living water continuously refreshing us. We have the Holy Spirit. That's something to be thankful for. That's something to be excited about, because we're not just dependent on a point in time to receive the Holy Spirit, but we have the Holy Spirit in us. We're the temples of the Holy Spirit. All of God's children have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now it's up to us how much we exercise that gift, about how much we fan that flame, allow God to bring the Holy Spirit out in us. But this young man, Elihu, who was, I don't know how long ago, thousands of years ago, probably hundreds or thousands of years before Abraham, this guy goes back to the very, very early patriarchs. He was full of the Holy Spirit for this moment in time, for a very special assignment. It was his time to speak. It was his time to bring out what was going on in the life of Job, and also in the life of those guys that Job had come to see as his tormentors rather than his friends. I see a couple of things in this guy that I want to share with you. And these came to me when I was reading the scriptures, and it's just some very simple points there in your bulletin. First of all, I see in this guy a spirit of humility. A spirit of humility. He comes before them, And, you know, he could have said a whole lot. He could have got mad. He could have tried to take over the conversation earlier and inject his point of view and make himself seem as smart and as wise as those older men. But he was humble. He was humble, and he knew the value of humility because God was working in his life. God said, I'll tell you when it's time to speak. This guy knew the Lord. This guy had, this wasn't his first rodeo. This was his time to demonstrate what God is doing in his life and be used by God to actually bring healing to a situation. Now, he uses some pretty sharp words. They were all pretty sharp with each other. They were kind of mean to each other, you know, especially Job and his friends. I mean, he has to get a little bit rough with them too, but sometimes we have to get a little bit rough with people to get them to listen to the truth, to let them know that this is what God is saying. But he did so in a spirit of humility. He said, I'm younger than all you guys. I've held my peace, and I defer to your wisdom. He respected his elders. He deferred to their wisdom. I believe his agenda was pure. He wasn't trying to promote himself. He wasn't trying to get some sort of a position or to get some sort of clout in the community. Probably just the opposite. He was risking his life or risking his whole reputation by coming against these guys who had much more power and authority than he did. Elihu simply wanted to speak the very heart of God into the matter. And dear friends, you think that's a lofty goal? You think that, wow, how can somebody do that? You can. I can. You have. I have. At times when we'll listen to God, when we listen to the situation, when we ask God to tune our hearts to a given situation, maybe we're talking with a friend who's going through a relationship struggle with his spouse. Maybe we're talking to a friend who is dancing on the very edge of moral failure. Maybe we're talking with a friend who needs some advice in their finances, who needs to learn how to follow God's principles for finances in the Word, and you see them making mistake after mistake. You ever known somebody who just seems, they just can't get it. They just keep spending money that they don't have. They just keep doing whatever, and you know that they're heading toward destruction. There comes a time, and we can't jump right in at times. We need to listen. We need to be humble. But there comes a time when God will give us the green light, and we can speak directly into someone's life. There's an old saying that I always try to remember. They don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. You got to develop a relationship with somebody. You can't just go up to a stranger. I feel like we have the kind of relationship here in this church where any one of you, I could talk to you in love. I could take you aside and say, dear brother, dear sister, this is what God's putting on my heart, and I just want to counsel you. I want to ask you to read God's word with me. Let's pray together. I'm concerned about you in an area. I see something going on in your life or in your family. I expect that you would do the same way to me. Don't say, well, he's the preacher. I can't come talk to him. I need that. I need that. If you see me dancing close to the edge, or if you see me oblivious to something that you believe God is trying to show this church or to show me, take me aside. Take me. I'll even buy your lunch if you'll come take me. Go to lunch with me. I'll take you to lunch and let you talk with me because I value you. I value the fact that you can hear from the Holy Spirit just as much as I can. Sometimes better than I can because preachers kind of get blinded to things sometimes. I need you. I need you, and I need you to speak into my life, and I want to be able to speak into your life, and I give you express permission to speak into my life. Y'all good with that? Y'all, may I speak into your life? Amen. That's what I'm here for, and that's what God has led me. That's what family does. Family doesn't mince words. Family talk to each other. That's what I see in this guy as opposed to the others. The others were about platitudes and about making speeches, and here's what I know, and I know all about God and know all about how he works. Elihu was just taking that in. He said, no. There'll come a time, and I'm going to speak what God is speaking to me. Humble. Agenda is pure. No agenda, really. He simply wanted to speak the heart of God into the matter. Listen, I'm redundant. I said, listen, he wanted to listen. He had a willingness and a patience to listen. To listen with no preconceived notions, no hasty conclusions. He didn't have a bunch of pat canned answers. You know, he didn't just say, well, here's what you do, 1, 2, 3, and you ought to be okay. He didn't have these pat canned answers. He had principles from God's word, and God makes things very clear in his word. If we'll read it, if we'll get into it, if we'll dig it, if we'll understand that it is not easy to understand at times, God makes us work for it. You know, some people, I read somewhere with a certain translation of the Bible, they were trying to make so simple that a third grader could read it. That's okay for a kid's Bible, but the Bible was designed, the Bible was written by holy men of God as the Holy Spirit spoke to them. And some of these passages are hard. Some of these passages will never be simple because part of the journey is we're supposed to grapple with it. That's like the book of Job. It's hard to understand. It's hard to bear. And we're supposed to go through there. And God uses that wonderfully constructed epic poem to get a hold of our spirit. To let these things, and as I've gone through it, I've read it many times before. This is the first time I've preached through it. God is showing me so many things. And we have to have a willingness and a patience to listen. No preconceived notions, no pat answers. Principles from God's word. You know, when we're talking to somebody, we may have some common experience, and it may be profitable at times to share what we've been through. But if you ever talk to somebody who just seemed to have all the answers, and it's just annoying, you really wish that you could actually have a discourse, a conversation, but they know all about it. And the conversation very quickly becomes all about them and their experience rather than about what you're failing at something and you need some help, and God has come to you and directed your path toward this person, and then all you hear is about their experience. I try to avoid that because sometimes it's easy to do. You'll start just talking about you. Here's what I do. Here's what I did. Here's why I'm so successful. And you can too. That's not much help, is it? That's not much help at all. We need to sit with somebody, love with somebody, and listen. First of all, we got to listen. There's a book, and I alluded to it, I think probably in Job somewhere before. Maybe it was in the Hebrews that we were doing before. But there's a book that really did impact my life. It's not a Christian book per se. Do y'all remember The 7 Habits of Highly Successful People by Stephen Covey? He wrote it in the 90s, and Stephen Covey has passed on by now. It was wildly successful, and it was everywhere in management circles, and I had to read it 2 or 3 times with different bosses, and we would go through these reading circles at work, and they even made these Franklin planners with all the habits of highly successful people in them back before we had cell phones and you had to keep a manual calendar. And y'all remember those days? And it was kind of the flavor of the month, but it was really better than that. I still have my copy, and I refer to it at different times because while not a Christian book per se, many of the principles are found in the scriptures. This is one of those principles. It's number 5 in the Habits of Highly Successful People by Stephen Covey. Seek first to understand and then to be understood. You got to listen first. You got to understand what someone is telling you. Understand what they're relating to you about their own experience. And then you can, once you fully have listened and understand the issue, then you can speak to it. That has played very, very significantly in my life, and it's found in the scriptures. I believe that Elihu is a prime example of a man who could listen, a man who could be slow to speak and would weigh things very carefully. He may have been young, but he was very, very wise. James 1:19 in the New Testament says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry." Boy, I wrestle with that in my own life. I hear that scripture pop up in my mind at times when I got a bit of a temper. Anybody have a temper and willing to admit it? Oh, come on. Y'all are nice. Y'all don't have tempers. I do. And something will just get me right in the guts sometime. It'll just get you right in the guts. And boy, have you ever really messed up by just throwing a fit about something? Just letting it out before you really understand what's going on. Before you really understand, and you wind up just making a mess of a situation. Lord, have I done that? Lord, have I got the scars to prove it too? I've tried to learn something over my 61 years, and sometimes I think I've done pretty good, but other times I don't think I've learned a thing. I just mess up like I always did. But I'm praying. I think God is working in me. I have tried to become slow to speak. Listen. You don't have to get your opinion on the table right away. Listen. And mostly you're not listening. Well, you're listening to the situation around you, but you're also listening for God. God will speak. It may not be right this second, though. It may take him a little while. He wants you to listen to some more stuff before he's going to be able to speak. We got to listen for his time. God is going to give us what we need in the appropriate time. In the meantime, we just need to hush our mouth and sit there and wait and not just sit there and fume and be mad. Listen! Listen to God. Listen to the problem. Listen to people around you. Oh, I've jumped the gun before. I've mouthed off. Later on, you realize you just made a mess, just made things much worse. You realize our words are the most powerful thing that we have control over. It's more powerful than any gun I own or any vehicle I own, or it's more powerful. It can do more damage. They can also do more good than anything in our possession, or our checkbook, in our antiques shelf, anything that we have. There's nothing more valuable than good words coming from our mouth. Nothing more productive, but there's also nothing more dangerous or more sinister than terrible words when we give our mouth to the enemy. I said a couple of weeks ago, God doesn't need for the devil to appear to us in all his whatever he looks like. You know, we picture him with the horns and the pitchfork and all that. He doesn't need to appear. He's got me. If I'll do what he asked me to do, if I'll lend my voice to him, if I'll lend my actions to him, I can do just fine for him if he'll allow it. By the other side, on the other side of the coin, the Holy Spirit wants to use me. Jesus doesn't need to walk down these aisles right here today. Matter of fact, if he came in, we would probably try to get him out of here. We wouldn't even know who he was, and we wouldn't, I don't know, maybe we'd recognize him, maybe we wouldn't. But I tell you what, I recognize him in you. I recognize him when I see him, and I know who's listening to him, and I know who's full of the Holy Spirit, and I know when I see it, someone who is humble, someone who is listening, someone who has a direct line to the heart of God. That's what I see in Elihu too. He had a direct line to the heart of God thousands of years before Jesus came to die for us. That's amazing. That's amazing. Throughout the Old Testament, we'll see different people. Moses, Joshua, Abraham, Isaac, all the Old Testament patriarchs. But this goes even back before them. Judaism was not even a truly organized religion. There was no temple. There was no priesthood. There were no Ten Commandments. Moses had never taught the precepts of the law to the people. This man was on his own. Probably out there in the Fertile Crescent somewhere, in the cradle of human civilization. He had these thousands of animals that God had blessed him with, and thousands of servants, and a virtual city that surrounded him. God had blessed this man so strongly, Job. And then he had saw his fortune and his family just decimated overnight. He had some serious questions. Job 16:2, "I have heard many such things. Miserable comforters are you all," he said. He said in Job 19:1, "How long will you torment me and crush me with your words? 10 times now you have reproached me. You shamelessly mistreat me." That's what the fellows had done to him, how they had made him feel by not listening to what he had to say and not trying to be helpful help. Listen, I can be a mouthpiece for life or for death, and I get to choose freely which words I speak. And I can bring life or I can bring death to a situation. I had a pastor friend, and still talk to him fairly regularly. And he told me something one day, and I have always imagined this. A good word picture helps me with my memorizing principles. He said, "Mark, every time you come up to a situation, any situation that seems to be smoldering, there may be a small fire, and maybe there's something about to go down." He said, "You got two buckets." He said, "You got a 5-gallon bucket in each hand. One of those buckets contains gasoline. You can dump a 5-gallon bucket of gasoline on that fire, or you can dump water on it. The other one's got water in it. You get to choose. You get to choose, and remember what's in which hand. Don't do the wrong one." But we get to choose. We can either inflame a situation, we can stir it up, we can make it worse, we can listen to somebody gripe and fuss and then start to agree with them, and pretty soon it gets blown completely out of proportion, and God is not honored, the devil is using us as our mouthpiece, or we can just pour water, cool water on that flame and put it out for good. Take a stick and stir it around and get all those coals done. It's done. Done. Put water on those situations, dear friends. Elihu had a direct line to the heart of God. And what he says when we begin to read that for several chapters, we'll understand that he's speaking by the Spirit of God. He refers to that several times. And God is using this young man to speak his truth. And as we go in probably next week's sermon, I'm going to talk about what God says. Because at some point, Elihu gets so close to what God's heart is saying, God just takes over. And it segues right into, I don't know where Elihu quits quite, but I think it's chapter 40 where God begins to speak from a whirlwind. But I believe the Holy Spirit just stirred his heart so much that God said, "This guy's doing such a good job, I'm coming down there to take over. I'm going to speak to these gentlemen, and I'm going to affirm what he's saying and continue the discourse." Interesting that we can listen to the heart of God, that the Holy Spirit can speak through us. Even though we consider ourselves frail, we're sinful people by nature. We're redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, and he has given us the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit comes with gifts. Amen? Every one of you have a spiritual gift. There's discernment, there's there's knowledge, there's prophecy. Speaking of prophecy, I heard a lady yesterday, and it's stuff I've heard and taught for years, but she taught it so beautifully on Facebook. A dear friend of mine who goes to Grace Fellowship, she did a video from her car. She was going to work out. It looked like she was going to go running or something. She said, I just feel led in my spirit to talk about this. And for about 15 minutes, she talked about prophesying over your life. You say, I'm not a prophet. That sounds kind of scary. Yes, you are. You're a prophet. The Holy Spirit has given you the capacity to prophesy. Now, I'm not going to ask you what the stock market's going to do tomorrow or to prophesy, you know, whatever's going to happen 2 years from now, 3 years from now. But prophecy in the New Testament sense has a different connotation. It's not so much a foretelling as it is a forthtelling, where you speak of the things of God, where you begin to speak the scriptures over your life and over your children. My children to this day, I made a lot of mistakes raising my children, but I got a hold of some very strong teaching in this area when they were young. And to this day, they'll tell you, Daddy, we remember when you would pray with us every night, and I'd prophesy over them. I'd lay my hands on my children, and Angie would come in there, and we would speak the word of God over their lives. That's powerful. And it's not my word, it's God's word. It's His promises. We lay hold of them. Sometimes when they were sleeping, I'd go by and I'd lay my hands on the door of their room. They'd have no idea I was there. Y'all done that. Some of y'all are looking at me. Y'all have done that, haven't you? Go by and just begin to pray. And not just beg God. And at times I would, oh God, we need some help. But begin to speak. Oh, children, you are strong in the Lord. You're anointed of God. You are blessed of God. You'll stand strong in this world. God will bless you. Bless your path with prosperity and peace and provision. And I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope in the future. Speak it. Speak it. The prophetic is a gift to you, dear friends, by the blood of Jesus and by the power of the Holy Spirit that He has given us. He's given you the ability to speak life. Oh, speak life. Don't speak things of death and doom. Speak life over your children and your grandchildren. I get Charlotte over to the house sometimes and I say, honey, you are so blessed. And I'll take her and she'll just smile at me. Jesus loves you. Jesus has great plans for you. Speak those words. I've got old Thomas to doing it too, my son-in-law. He speaks words of life over her. I don't know that I got him to doing it, but he does it. And it's a generational thing that we're passing down. And that's the way God works, dear friends. I just wanted to encourage you in that area. I got a little bit off track doing that. But let's go to these concluding points. I think it's about time to start wrapping up. Some concluding points. My printer was doing some weird things today, so I kind of got some multicolors. I had to change ink right in the middle, and I don't think it worked out too well. Hopefully it'll be good when I get home. I get it fixed. Concluding points. Number one, seek counsel from those people whose words give glory to God. And they do not accuse. They do not accuse. You ever talk? We talked about that. You've talked to the wrong person before. And you go away feeling worse than when you first came in. I've got a guy that I talk to sometimes. And I'm not a bit afraid to admit to you that I like to go to counseling sometimes. I'm a huge fan of the counseling process. Just be careful who you choose to counsel you. I went to one guy for a time and I really liked him. But he was kind of cynical. And he knew the scriptures as much as I did. And then come to find out he was agnostic. And I asked him, I said, how do you know all these scriptures? He said, because I grew up just like you. But he said, I just realized one day that I just believe that all religions are right. Well, I like him. He's a very nice guy, but I just didn't want to go back anymore when I realized that he didn't have the same very foundation that I have. But a guy that I go see now, on occasion, we'll get together. He's the kind of guy that I kind of wish he wasn't my counselor so he could be my friend. You know, we'd rather do stuff with him. But such a nice guy. And he always speaks life. He always speaks positive things, and he knows the scriptures, and he knows all y'all. He knows your names, I think. Probably, maybe not your names, but he knows about the church because he always asks me about it. We talk about what God is doing in the church. He's a devout Catholic, and he actually converted from Methodism to Catholicism some years ago. But we have the same heart. We have the same beat. And seek counsel from people who are helpful help. Don't seek counsel from the world. We don't need the counsel of the world. We need the counsel of God, and we need people who know Jesus to be able to talk with us. When something gives you a pause, pay attention to that and pause and take it to the Lord and to the Word in prayer. Listen to God more than you speak. Pray the Scriptures. Remind God of His promise and seek His discernment. You have the opportunity to hear from and speak to His heart directly. And here's the second point of conclusion. When you are standing on the word of God, be as bold as a lion like Elihu. David told us in Psalm 28:1, the wicked flee. I'm sorry, that was Solomon in Proverbs. The wicked flee when no one pursues, but the righteous are Say it with me. Bold as a lion. Remember that. God doesn't call you to be meek and cowering, and meekness is not weakness. God does not call you to be weak. He calls us to be meek. God calls us to be bold, to stand on the truth and be like a lion, like a as bold as a lion. Finally, ask God to help you listen to people without rushing to judgment or conclusion. We got to be able to listen. We got to be able to empathize with someone. They don't care how much we know until they know how much we care. Finally, realize our common temptation to agree with the accuser and to be his mouthpiece. It's so easy just to fall right in there and start accusing people and start to believe the worst and to always be down on somebody, to be cynical, to always say, well, where there's smoke, there's a fire, and you're not telling me the whole truth. What's going on here? Seek to understand before you speak. Breathe a prayer to God even as you were listening to a situation. I do that. When I'm talking with someone, if you talk to me after church and maybe you start sharing a family situation or something going on in your life that you need prayer for, I'm praying the whole time. You know, you can do that. You can multitask. I can be totally tuned to what you're saying, but in my heart, in my spirit, oh God, help me. Help me, Lord. I'm listening, Lord. Boy, I'm going too long. It's 12:16. I guess I better hush. But I'll preach another hour if y'all stay. Glory to God. Let's pray. Oh Lord, listen just for a minute, hear what God's saying. He's going to say something different to every one of us, I bet, but speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Embrace the silence just for a moment. The words that I've said today from the Word of God, they may have spawned 20 different sermons in here. You may have heard what God is saying to you, and I would love to hear it. Share it with me. God, help us, Lord. Teach us, Lord. Let us be listeners. God, let us be like Elihu, people who don't accuse, people who listen to the Holy Spirit and were willing to be righteous and bold as a lion and speak your truth, Lord Jesus. Well, thank you for your Word. God, bless us today. God, let it be healing to us, Lord. Let us be your eyes and your ears, Lord, as we listen to people around us, God. Let us not be accusers. Let us be those who build with our words, those who speak life and happiness and loveliness of Jesus to people, Lord. Let us be the ones who make the world hungry for you, Lord Jesus. Blessed be your name, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. What are we going to sing, Tony?
I like that victory in Jesus.
Let's do it again. That's fine. Listen, we don't ever have an altar call here, but you know you're always welcome to come pray. This here, that's what this altar is for. Come pray anytime. I'll pray with you anytime. Let's sing. Son, and the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Fellowship with one another.
Amen.
love this boy. He come to me, didn't he?
He did.
He loves his preacher, and I love him. Folks on the internet, we love you. God bless you. Thank you for joining us today. And we look forward to hearing from you. Let us know your praise and your prayer requests. We love you. God bless you. Bye-bye.